Hey, John, how are you?
Good to see you, sir.
Okay, you're good to see you.
You're good. Just go over to the front. That's good.
Let me ask you, first of all, do you have any sense whether Mr. Rhodes hurt his prospects and hurt his sentence with his remarks?
I don't. And I think I was asked if it hurt his sentence with him being on the radio the other day. I don't think so. The reason is Judge Mehta was a very thoughtful judge. And what I mean by that is he puts a lot of effort and a lot of thought into the decisions he makes. As you heard, as most of you probably heard, his recitation leading up to the sentencing for 30 or 45 minutes. He put a lot of thought into this for a long time. He sat through three of these trials. He's got 20-plus oath keepers to sentence, and he's got to do it comparatively. There's a provision in the code that says that's why he asked the prosecutor yesterday, why are you asking for 25, and what are you going to do with these other guys? So I think he genuinely cares about doing it correctly, and I just think he put a lot of effort into it.
Did you think that was a just sentence?
I can't answer that. I mean, we have differences of opinion on some of the evidence. Of course, I wanted less. The prosecutors wanted more. But based on Judge Mehta's belief of what the facts show and his recitation of that yesterday and today, I believe that was lower than what I thought Mehta would do.
It was lower than you thought
today. Yeah. After today, I thought it would be higher.
Do you think you did the best job you could do as a lawyer for Stuart Rhodes?
I do.
Quickly working our asses off.
Yeah.
We've given a year and a half of our life to this. I think as a lawyer representing and advocating for a client, you always look back and you're second guessing yourself. You always see things you could do differently. I genuinely don't think we could have in any way worked any harder than we did. This upended our lives. Not that that's what that's about. It's not. But this took a toll on everyone. And in terms of what you asked about the sentencing, we're clearly Stuart's advocates. And I, like Philip had just detailed, as I was listening to Judge Mehta speak, and then take that extra step to say that at no point during his career in sentencing has he ever had the opportunity to look at a pending defendant and say, I consider you a future danger to the future of the country. And when I heard that, not unlike Philip just stated, I anticipated much higher than an 18-year sentence. Not that I agree with the sentence, but I anticipated much more based on the way that he was leading up to it.
So can you, the judge had much to say about sort of the future of our democracy and your client's role and any sort of threat to that. Can you speak to that? Can you also tell us, you know, how Rhodes is feeling? Can you talk to him since the sentence was handed down?
I think the judge is speaking to the fact that Rhodes continually gets on the radio, continually speaks about these things. I mean, just recently, 4 days ago, and I think the judge is referencing those things. Rhodes is not going to be quiet. Rhodes has an opinion. He's going to get it out there. There's a lot of people that believe his opinions are correct. The judge does not.
And we've never tried to silence him at all.
Wait, what about the First Amendment? Doesn't Stuart have the right to the First Amendment freedom of speech?
Clearly
that'll be part of appellate issues. Yes, absolutely. And we've never tried to silence.
What do you think, Ed? Speak up, Ed.
Well, I think that this case was all about the weaponization of speech by the Department of Justice. And I think that essentially they had used Stuart Rhodes' words against him. It was not what his actions were, but it was his words. I mean, Mr. Bright and Mr. Linder and I all argued that he never went into the Capitol, he never assaulted anyone, he never destroyed any property. We argued all those matters during the trial and post-trial. And clearly, the words of Stuart Rhodes is what the judge returned to time and time again, what he had said over a long period of time. And just as Mr. Linder said, had he been in Austin, Texas on January 6th and not in Washington, D.C., would he have been indicted and prosecuted? No, because it was his words. And so the fact of the matter is that we think that ultimately this is going to be about free speech. We think that we have a good appeal coming on this. We look forward to the appeal and appellate process. And, you know, we stand firmly behind Stuart Rhodes. You know, we don't think he's a threat to society. We don't think that at all. And, you know, absolutely he has a right to free speech. And you know, none of us have ever tried to tell Stewart what to do. And he's been able to speak freely all during this time.
He thinks he's a political prisoner.
Well, he is a political prisoner, okay? Look, he is a graduate of Yale Law School. He wrote a paper that won a prize at Yale about civil rights and
enemy combatants.
Enemy combatants. I mean, his thinking is very deep and nuanced. And I think that we will see this
so
play out.
Why did he when he wrote it?
Because it was his words that led him to where he is and not his actions. There's no way that he was the leader or the director of what happened on January 6th. He was just a convenient target. The Oath Keepers were a convenient target. The DOJ looked at them and said, here are the scapegoats of what happened on January 6th. We all know that the Capitol had been breached. We all know that people were already in there.
I hope that
Stewart never went in the Capitol.
Did you have a question?
So Stewart Rhodes wasn't the leader, wasn't responsible for January 6th. Who was?
Absolutely not. Go ahead.
I think that's a huge question. Look, in terms of leader of January 6th, there were 10,000 plus people on the Hill that day. And it was uncontroverted evidence that Mr. Rhodes, with the co-conspirator indicted now, Kelly Sorrell, they weren't even on the Hill when this entire situation started. I don't think it's up to me to point the finger and place blame on ultimately any given individual. I know that there is a large swath of society that intends to and will be pointing blame to the very top of what was the American society at the time. And I'll leave it to them to do that. We don't have a dog in that fight. Our dog in the fight was Mr. Rhodes. This is a year and a half now, cap ended into this with an 18-year sentence, and there will be appellate issues.
The impact of this sentence will be on other defendants in this case, and the other defendants still come.
I think it'll be huge. This is the biggest sentence that's been handed down so far. The next one is 14 years. It's the only sentence that's been handed down for seditious conspiracy. And 30 years, I think. And so I think this speaks volumes to what other defendants could be looking at if they pled to or get convicted of seditious conspiracy.
Can you speak to what it was like in the courtroom when the judge was handing down the sentence? What was your reaction?
It's the quietest courtroom I've ever been in my entire 28 years of practice. It was stunningly silent.
Yes.
And people, to Mehta's credit, his presentation was powerful. His words were thought out. Whether you agree or disagree, it goes without question that he put an enormous amount of time and thought into his decision and his presentation. And for lack of a better way of saying it, I think the entire gallery was hanging on every word that he was saying.
Yeah.
The judge had said that he viewed Mr. Rhodes as an ongoing danger and peril. Is he going to continue trying to galvanize people around the country politically?
Only Rhodes can answer that.
Only he can answer that.
True.
I would say that his demeanor at the time the sentence was handed down was that he was stoic, he was resolute, he was determined, he didn't speak to us at all. He took it, he wrote it down, and he went on.
Do you feel like Judge Mehta respects the First Amendment
Thank
of the United
guys.
States
I'm
of America?
I'm going to get back for a minute.
Do you feel like he respects the First Amendment?
No. Anybody
yeah, yes. Absolutely. Look, I think Judge Mehta treated the defense lawyers well in this case. We were able to argue all of our points. I think Mr. Linder would agree with me on that. We were never prevented from arguing the things that we needed to argue.